Yeah, I'm going to talk about Sayyid Jamal al-Din, and one aspect that I would like to emphasize in particular is his background and his training in the Irfan, and how it sort of inspired and led to developing sort of modern forms of Islamic activism. So I will provide a brief overview of the life and career of Sayyid Jamal Al-Astarabadi, also known as Al-Afghani. I mean, I put it in inverted commas. I mean, when we were sort of planning the lecture, I mean, because in academic discourse, I mean, all the publications obviously refer to him as Al-Afghani, and Shaykhi School was always saying Al-Astarabadi. So we already had a sort of conflicting use of the name. So for the purpose of the lecture, I will just talk about Sayyid Jamal or Sayyid Jamal al-Din. But again, it's part of his reputation, part of his sort of activism and how he presented himself to different audiences. He is obviously one of the most prominent Muslim activists of the 19th century. Again, I want to explore in particular his sort of training in sort of traditional Shi'i scholarship and his particular interest in Irfan and how it relates to his political activism. Within the 19th century, in the Iranian context, the most prominent expression of Islam was the so-called of Irfan was the so-called Shaykhi school. So, I will talk a little bit about his relationship to the Shaykhi school. And again, talking about the connection between his sort of mystical and philosophical interests and his prominent role as an anti-imperialist Muslim activist. I want to raise also some sort of more profound question of his sort of lasting influence in the creation of modern forms of Islamic activism. Now, when we want to understand a figure like Sayyid Jamal al-Din, we need to understand the particular context in which he was placed and the events that he encountered that shaped his particular approach to modernizing, reforming Islam. And of course, when we talk about the context in which he was placed is the rise of European imperialism in the 19th century. I mean, what we see from the mid-19th century onwards, a momentum of European colonialism in the Middle East and North Africa and other parts of the Muslim world. I mean, I'll just throw some dates at you, some sort of significant events, which show how, if you like, European colonialism took hold over many parts of the Muslim world and how a person like, say, Jamal al-Din responded to these particular events. So we have, in North Africa, the French conquest of Algeria. We have the establishment of British rule in India following the so-called Indian Mutiny in 1858. Until then, at least nominally, India was ruled by a Muslim dynasty. So again, a change of power. A Muslim ruling dynasty was replaced by European colonial powers. We have the French conquest of Tunisia in 1881, and later on, the British occupation of Egypt in 1882. So again, for an observer, for, if you like, a politically engaged Muslim thinker, intellectual activist, you know, these events happening within a few decades were alarming. And again, there's a strong sense in Afghani, you know, many of his contemporary Muslim reformers, that the traditional Muslim elites, you know, the political leaders, and, if you like, the traditional, you know, scholars, failed to respond to these new political realities, the actual threat of European colonialism appropriately. Very often, the political elites in Muslim-majority societies were more or less willing to cooperate, to collaborate with the colonial powers, saw that as a way to retain their elite status, their status of power. And the traditional religious scholars very often lacked, if you like, the intellectual, the cultural means to respond to this challenge appropriately. And of course, in this sense, Sayyid Jamal al-Din is quite significant as being one of the first who responded to this new situation, to this challenge, and whose influence stretches up to the contemporary period. Now, what is quite striking, I mean, we talked about the different nisbas that are used, and again, because he's such a prominent figure, I suppose everybody wants to have a little part and piece of him, and so on. Of course, he was also playing with his identities. I mean, it's very clear that he had an Iranian background. You know, people suggest, you know, he presented himself in the Arab world in the context of the Sunni Ottoman Empire deliberately as an Afghani, as a Sunni Muslim, in order to avoid potentially sectarian tensions, you know, to be more sort of acceptable as a kind of pan-Islamic, you know, universal Islamic reformer. But what is also quite interesting about the life of Afghani is a certain restlessness. And that's why I put this map. I mean, it's a bit anachronistic because it's a contemporary map, to show or to give you at least some indication of all the places where he's been. I mean, he was traveling around the Muslim world. He was traveling to Europe as part of the actors, and he'd never really stayed for more than a couple of years, and sometimes a few months, at one place. Partially because he was perhaps a bit restless and felt, you know, I need to respond to European colonialism, and nobody's really, you know, moving, nobody's really responding to it. But the other reason is he also, I mean, he was, or he must have been quite a charismatic figure, quite an appealing figure, you know, winning the trust and confidence of people, but he also managed to antagonize people because of certain things he said, in particular because of his critique of, if you like, indigenous Muslim political elites for their failure to respond to the challenge of European imperialism appropriately, and of course his critique of, you know, traditional ulama for the lack of engagement with modern ideas. So, I mean, he was born in Asadabad in Iran, you know, moved to Qazvin, to Tehran for his training. He moved to Najaf to continue his training. Again, there are all sorts of stories around his experience there in Najaf. Some people suggest that he didn't complete because he antagonized the kind of clerical establishment in Najaf in particular. Again, there are all sorts of stories and some myths around it. I mean, one of the themes that around Afghani that emerges very often is, you know, apart from his very strong charismatic personality, you know, he's a great orator, great speaker, and so on, but apparently also had a certain messianic aura. I mean, there are always stories that either he claimed to be the Mahdi, or at least some of his followers believed that he is the Mahdi. So again, there are stories that he was sort of kicked out of Najaf because he claimed to be the Mahdi, or people believed to be the Mahdi. Others say, well, it wasn't as dramatic as these stories suggest. It was more because of his rather sort of unconventional intellectual interest. I mean, he was particularly interested in philosophy, in Irfan, and so on, and that was not sort of well recognized within the clerical establishment in Najaf. Others say he wasn't very popular there because he was quite lax about following Islamic rituals. So again, he's always portrayed as a very controversial figure who sort of swam against the stream, who provoked certain people, maybe deliberately, involuntarily, and who challenged views that were held by the majority of people. He went to Afghanistan, Herat at that time. He went to India, which was quite a significant experience there. He was in Istanbul for a couple of years. He was in Cairo. Again, I'll talk about this in more detail later on. So again, you can see he was sort of active in all the major cities of the Muslim world at this time, connecting with very influential people. He was in London, sort of lobbying against British colonialism, British imperialism in the Muslim world. He was a few years in Paris, publishing a journal. I mean, I'll talk a little bit of this later. He was in Russia, Moscow, St. Petersburg, again, to meet influential intellectuals, journalists, to meet politicians, to find ways to forge alliances to counter European imperialism. So again, this is just sort of to illustrate a little bit the kind of restlessness of his life, the fact that he traveled a lot. And I think it might say something about, say, Jamal's personality, sort of one thing. The other aspect, because he moved around quite a lot, you know, he was, in a sense, in all the major places of the Muslim world at that time, and perhaps this created a sense of Islamic unity. I mean, he encountered, he experienced Muslims of different backgrounds that obviously shared a certain sense of frustration with the state of Islam at that time, the threat of European colonialism, and perhaps the fact that he moved around and met Muslims in India, in Afghanistan, in Egypt, in the Ottoman Empire, you know, created a sense of Islamic unity, which is quite a central element in terms of his own teachings. Yes, I mean, the map, just sort of to illustrate a little bit the sort of the restlessness of his life, to give you sort of an indication of all the places he went to. Again, it's impossible to give sort of a complete outline of his life, his biography, his various activities. So I'm just going to highlight a few sort of important stations. Obviously, his early years are quite significant. Again, he received initial training as an alim in Iran, and, you know, in terms of his own family background, the kind of education institutions, the houses that he attended, he was apparently particularly interested in Irfan and its most prominent 19th century expression, the Shaykhi School. I don't know how familiar you are with the Shaykhi School. Again, it's sort of an early 19th century movement in 12 Shia Islam. The founding figure is Sheikh Ahmad al-Asai. And what he tries to do is to combine the diverse and rich intellectual traditions of Shia Islam or of the whole Islamic tradition together. He wants to sort of create a synthesis of the various, often competing, conflicting strands of Islamic intellectual history together. So, you know, obviously, as a 12 Shia emphasizing wilaya, the belief in imama as a set, sort of central component, but he's also strongly influenced by Sufi ideas, Ibn Arabi, you know, the notion of the perfect man, the idea that there is on earth in creation always one person who is the link, the connection between God and creation, you know, the perfect man, if you like, the qutb, the pole of the universe. He also is influenced by sort of rationalistic philosophy. Ibn Sina tries to bring this on board, and of course also emphasizes training fiqh. So again, an effort to bring together all these different strands of Islamic intellectual thoughts and heritage into a synthesis. I mean, there's not really a distinction, a contradiction between them. They all ultimately lead to the same goal. And I think this kind of intellectual outlook is quite important. I might come back to this later on. In terms of, I mean, if you sort of trained in an intellectual environment that says, well, whether it's philosophy, whether it's Irfan, whether it's Na'ashari, they all lead to the same goal. There's no contradiction between these different sources of knowledge and these different, if you like, intellectual approaches to acquire knowledge. If you're trained in such an environment, it is perhaps easier to accept sort of Western knowledge, Western science. Say, well, if I can read Aristotle as part of my philosophical training, why can't I read 19th century European philosophers? Why can't I engage with sort of modern science and see how we can appropriate that as Muslims in the contemporary context? I mean, I'll come to that later on, hopefully. Again, scholarship on Sayyid Jamal al-Din would argue that his stay in India had a profound impact on him. Again, it's still not entirely clear how it all happened and what he encountered, but obviously he was in India at around the time of the so-called Indian Mutiny or its immediate aftermath and the time when sort of British colonial rule was firmly established in India. So maybe after that, maybe exactly at the time. And of course, at that time, there were sort of many revolts, rebellions by, you know, various religious groups. Sikhs, for example, rebelled against the establishment of British colonial rule. And there were various Muslim revolts by various groups, again, British colonial rule. So he saw that. I mean, until then, I mean, there was sort of nominally a Muslim rule in India, but of course, most of India was controlled by the East India Company, which was sort of private enterprise that began to colonize India. And the Indian Mutiny was basically, or as it's called in Indian historical writing, the first war of independence. Again, you know, it's a kind of British perspective to call it the mutiny, you know, sort of soldiers, Hindu, Muslim soldiers, working for the East India Company, sort of undertaking a mutiny, it's kind of very sort of Eurocentric British perspective, again, in Indian historical writings known as the First War of Independence, so the first revolt against British colonial rule. So there was a mutiny which failed, was crushed, and British rule was firmly established. So in a sense, people argue that this sort of Indian experience made Afghani aware, Sayyid Jamal al-Din, I was planning to refer to it this way, Sayyid Jamal al-Din aware of the danger of European imperialism, particularly British colonialism, and its impact it has on, if like, not just Muslim societies, but sort of non-European societies more generally. There's also the argument that in India, he had his first encounter with sort of modern European philosophy, modern science. We don't really know much about this, in which context it emerged, what kind of impact it has. Again, we might speculate that maybe somebody like Sayyid Jamal al-Din, who had this sort of open, perhaps unconventional intellectual outlook, you know, he was more willing to engage with these ideas than others. Again, he moved around. I mean, he was very good, Sayyid Jamal al-Din, to make connections with very influential people who sort of introduced him to other influential people. I mean, that was sort of one of his particular strengths. But also, because of certain ideas he put forward, he managed to antagonize people and, you know, was a controversial figure. I mean, he gave a sort of very controversial lecture, and again, in a kind of a modern sort of institution of higher education that was established by the Ottoman Sultan's Darul-Ulum in Istanbul, which was controversial, again, for at least for sort of a mainstream Sunni audience, maybe for other audiences it wouldn't be that controversial, because he compares prophets with philosophers. I mean, he sort of diminishes the distinction between prophets and philosophers as individuals that are intellectually gifted, that receive particular knowledge from God, that have different approaches towards the truth, but ultimately lead to the same truth, which sort of ideas he adopted from Ibn Sina. He was then for a couple of years in Egypt, and in a sense, these were perhaps his most productive years. Again, he was involved in all sorts of political activities. Again, he was a very much sort of kind of a political person and so on, and of course saw the immediate threats of sort of British control over Egypt. So he attacked, again, the political elites, the ruler of Egypt, tried to sort of organize opposition to politicians, you know, the political elite that was willing to collaborate with the British. But although these things didn't really materialize, Egypt was occupied by Britain in 1882. Perhaps these here are the most productive years because he established a circle of disciples that would later become very influential Muslim reformers, Egyptian politicians. I mean, one figure I'm going to talk about a bit later on is Muhammad Abdu, who obviously met Afghani in Egypt, became one of his closest disciples, but also other figures that would later on, in the early 20th century, play an important role in Egypt's struggle for independence, such as Saad Zahloul and so on. They became part of his disciples. And again, he was a figure, you know, he motivated these people to become politically active. He played also a very important role in promoting the sort of emerging Egyptian public sphere. So, you know, this time, 1870s, early 1880s, we have, you know, the emergence of newspapers like Al-Ahram, other newspapers, and he encouraged people to be involved in these activities, to write articles about political, social issues and so on, again, to create sort of new platforms to talk about, if you like, modern ideas, you know, recognizing that, traditional means to disseminate ideas did not work. And again, in terms of the circle of disciples he had in Egypt, yes, you know, prominent people, Muslim reformers like Muhammad Abdu, but also he was working with Jewish intellectuals. You know, Al-Ahram was founded by two, Syrian brothers, Christian brothers. So, I mean, again, he was working with various people in these various endeavors. Again, I'm sort of skipping certain things, just sort of highlighting, if you like, the most important elements of his career. His experience in India, again, people say it instilled in him, you know, a strong hatred for the British, but certainly an acute awareness of the perils, the problems of sort of European imperialism. And again, he was a political person looking, well, who could oppose the threat and the real threat of British imperialism in the Middle East and in the wider Muslim world? And of course, in the European context, the main rival of Britain was France. So he was in Paris, you know, trying to forge or win sort of French support for an alliance that would also include Russia, kind of another sort of rival of Britain, and also that would include the Ottoman Empire to forge a kind of French-Russian-Ottoman alliance against British imperialism. And again, the reference to the Ottoman Empire was important to him because that was sort of an example of, you know, the last remaining sort of independent imperial power in the Middle East that perhaps could withstand European imperialism. But also, Afghani was aware of the kind of symbolic capital of the Ottoman Empire, and the Ottoman Sultan obviously also claimed to be the caliph of Islam, you know, the successor of the Prophet Muhammad as leader of the Islamic Ummah. And although Ottoman sultans might have carried this for whatever reasons as part of the title, it became sort of more pronounced in the late 19th century. And again, Afghani was somebody who supported this because he felt, you know, there's kind of a political power that has symbolic capital that could be utilized to counter European imperialism. He published a journal together with his disciple Muhammad Abdu al-Owwa al-Wuthqa, it's a Quranic term, you know, the firmest bond. And again, the Ottoman Sultan, or the Ottoman Caliphate, was seen as al-Owwa al-Wuthqa, the firmest bond to which Muslims should cling to achieve Muslim unity. And these articles, again, this was published there, sent to intellectual scholars across the Muslim world. And I mean, these articles, particularly the one, I mean, it was sort of a magazine talking about political development, sort of revealing the mechanisms of British imperialism, offering, you know, the Ottoman Caliphate as kind of a counterweight to European imperialism. But the articles, I mean, the sort of more philosophical articles are addressing, you know, the educated elite of the Muslim world. I mean, if you've seen them, I mean, they're written in the most eloquent Arabic. I mean, extremely difficult, extremely sophisticated Arabic, very, very difficult to read, to untranslate, and so on. So again, using also Arabic and sort of to, obviously, a sort of unifying language, but also addressing in particular an educated elite across the Muslim world. And what these articles do, you know, emphasizing Islamic unity, they present Islam for the first time in a modern context as an anti-imperialist ideology. People have referred to it as sort of pan-Islamism, sort of Islamic universalism. So arguing that within an Islamic context, ethnicity is secondary. You know, if you're Iranian, if you're Kurdish, Turkish, Arab, you know, all these sort of ethno-linguistic national markers of identity are irrelevant. You know, the first reference point, the first marker of identity is the Ummah, the Islamic community. So there's a kind of conception of the Ummah as a political entity, as a religiously, Islamically defined nation. So again, sort of Islamic unity, kind of an Islamic understanding of nationalism as a counterweight to sort of ethnic linguistic forms of nationalism. Again, arguing, for example, that these various forms of nationalism that began to emerge in debates of intellectuals in the 19th century were part of a colonial plot to undermine Islamic solidarity and Islamic unity. So suddenly Iranians began to be proud of being Iranian, Egyptians saw themselves primarily as Egyptians and so on, Turkish national identity emerged, and again, the articles in Al-Wal Wuthqa sort of presented as part of kind of colonial plot to undermine that the belief that ultimate allegiance should belong to Islam and the Islamic community. What Afghani, Sayyid Jamal al-Din was hoping to achieve with his journal was obviously to mobilize the intellectual political elites to achieve unity, to fight against British imperialism. I mean, that didn't really happen, but nevertheless, the way how he conceived Islam in the articles of this journal would have a lasting impact on modern Islamic discourse. Again, the sort of the later years of his life, again, traveling a lot, again, he was sort of working for sort of political activism, you're trying to get, you know, the Tsar of Russia, you know, France and the Ottoman Empire sort of together to forge an alliance against British colonialism. Right, so as we can see, we have with Sayyid Jamal al-Din a figure, you know, very restless, you know, a political person involved in sort of seeking to create alliances, maybe a bit too idealistic, optimistic at times in terms of what he could actually achieve, working as kind of an anti-imperialist Muslim activist. So what I'm trying to do now is kind of to have some sort of assessment of him and sort of look at, well, what is his impact? I mean, again, he was certainly, in the 19th century, an important and pioneering promoter of Islamic unity against European imperialism. Again, conceiving for the first time Islam as a kind of anti-imperialist ideology that, you know, should unite Muslims to fight against European imperialism. And this kind of discourse that is very strong in the articles of Al-Awwal Wuthqa would have a lasting effect on, you know, 20th century Islamic discourse, Islamic political discourse, and I mean up to the present. One can say. So although his immediate goals were not really fulfilled, you know, people didn't read it and, you know, united and fought against British colonialism, but in terms of creating a particular understanding of Islam as a unifying religion or ideology against European imperialism, this is obviously something, I don't need to tell you that, that had a lasting impact on 20th century Muslim activists and so on. The other sort of lasting impact is, and I mentioned this earlier, that he was a teacher and mentor of very influential Muslim reformers. I mean, Muhammad Abdu, you know, one of the most influential, you know, 19th century Muslim reformers. We wouldn't have Muhammad Abdu if it were not for Sayyid Jamal al-Din. You know, he was the one, and I talk about this in a minute as well, who encouraged Abdu to become politically involved, again, to write articles in sort of the emerging sort of Egyptian press, and to become politically active as well. And, you know, other people that he sort of trained and mentored in Egypt were similar, encouraged to become politically active. So, although, again, he might have failed in sort of achieving his immediate goals, in terms of the kind of generation of reformers and thinkers he created, you know, certainly a lasting impact. Now, there is a certain ambivalence around that. I mentioned already, you know, these different names he has and he used and how he played with different identities and the rumors that he claimed to be the Mahdi or people believed him to be the Mahdi. So, you know, there are all these kind of controversies around them. Obviously, some might just have been put into the arena by his detractors, you know, people who didn't like him, who wanted to undermine him and say, well, he claims to be the Mahdi, or, you know, again, of course, this is sort of part of all these political games. He had a very strong elitist approach, which again is probably, and we want to understand, you know, where he's coming from, part of his training in Irfan, which obviously is an elitist tradition in Islam. I mean, not everybody can become an Arif. Not everybody can become Al-Insan Al-Kamil. Within Irfan, there is a strong sense of what we might call spiritual elitism, that, if you like, the highest degrees of spiritual perfection and, you know, if you bring in sort of rationalistic philosophy, intellectual perfection are only attainable to a few people. So he was certainly intellectually and spiritually an elitist person. He didn't really believe in mass mobilization. You know, rather, most people don't understand anything. What you need is an enlightened elite that guides people. And apart from this kind of spiritual intellectual elitism, there's a strong political elitism. Because if you look, I mean, I showed the map of all the places he went to, you know, Istanbul, Cairo, and so on. He always wanted to meet the political elites, the rulers, the influential politicians, influential intellectuals. Because again, he felt it's the head that moves the entire body. So if he convinced the head or the heads of the Muslim Ummah to move into a particular direction, you know, the rulers, we will be successful. So he wasn't a kind of what we might call nowadays a grassroots activist. So sort of, you know, we need to educate the people and, you know, make them more, you know, religiously aware, politically aware. We need to mobilize the masses and so on. That was not his approach. He was very elitist, distrusting the masses, you know, saying, well, they don't really have the intellectual, political means to change anything. It's only the elites. And again, I think it, you know, it stems partially from his training within sort of, you know, Irfan and sort of spiritual elitist traditions. And then maybe accounts also for the fact that he might have represented himself towards different audience in different ways. Again, not that if you talk to an ordinary person, you need to use a different language. You need to communicate a message differently. Whereas if you address sort of an educated, highly sophisticated person, you know, you can, you know, use a different language. So again, which is part of Irfan, the kind of Irfan approach towards education, that people have different needs, they have different backgrounds, they have different capacities, and you need to present yourself accordingly if you want to have an impact. Yes, and then, I mean, it's quite amazing. I mean, he managed to meet all the major sort of movers and shakers of the 19th century Muslim world and so on, but maybe he was a bit too close to those in power. I mean, again, based on his kind of elitist approach, he was perhaps trusting too much those in power, you know, leading then to his sort of, maybe downfall might be a bit too strong, but obviously he didn't really achieve his goals, and he died alone in Istanbul. You know, there was not much discussion. I mean, there were not major, you know, obituaries published or anything like that when he died. I mean, he died on his own in solitude, and even, you know, his close disciples didn't really notice his death. They didn't say anything about it as such. And maybe again, he was perhaps too close to people who had power and manipulated other people. Right. So, in a nutshell, this is sort of Afghani. What I want to do now is to talk a bit of, I mean, I did it already, but I want to do it a bit more detail about the kind of intellectual roots of the style of modern Islamic activism that he created in his biography, but also in terms of his sort of publications and sort of teaching, establishing a circle of disciples and so on. And part of that, I want to challenge sort of Orientalist discourse around the place of Sufism, or Irfan, within modern Islam. I mean, there's, you know, within, you know, 19th century Orientalist scholarship and up to the sort of the mid, maybe late 20th century Orientalist scholarship on Islam, there's very often a perception or construction of Sufism to be outside of Orthodox Islam, you know, not to be really part of the Islamic tradition, you know, something that is heterodox, that is heretical. That's sort of one discourse, sort of sidelining Sufism or Irfan from mainstream Islam, sort of ignoring the central role it has played historically. The other approach argues that there's something inherently anti-modern in Sufism or Irfan. And because of the sort of essentially anti-modern element of Sufism, modern Muslim reformers were fiercely opposed to Sufism, you know, saying it's obscurantist, traditional, irrational, that Sufism is responsible for the decline of Islam, because Sufis believe sort of in the blind obedience to authority, they have a kind of fatalistic attitude towards life, and are, you know, otherworldly oriented. They're not interested in this world. This assumption, which is very strong in, you know, academic scholarship on Sufism, at least until the 1980s, 1990s, is based on a very selective reading of statements by Muslim reformers who certainly rejected certain aspects of Sufism, such as, you know, the misuse of the authority of the Sheikh, you know, the blind belief in miracles, or sort of popular practices, you know, part of, you know, beliefs around, you know, miracles and miraculous powers that are associated to Sufi Sheikhs, and are sort of branded as superstitious. But what the scholarship ignores is that this kind of critical discourse around certain aspects of Sufism has always been part of Islamic debates around the place of Sufism. And it's also part of debates within Sufism itself, but it doesn't necessarily mean an outright rejection of Sufism within Islam. And I suppose within the context of Iranian Shiism, this kind of critical discourse, this kind of critical attitude towards Sufism or certain aspects of the Sufi tradition is articulated, expressed in the distinction made between tasawwuf and irfan. Whereas, you know, I suppose within mainstream Iranian Shiism, you know, tasawwuf would be sort of seen as a reference to, if you like, tariqa-style Sufism, you know, the organized form of Sufism, which is viewed with suspicion. But if you like, you have the term irfan, referring, if you like, to the philosophical heritage, the philosophy of Sufism, which obviously is part of Iranian Shiism, is part of the Hausa curriculum, and so on. So in a sense, you know, I want to challenge this big depiction of Orientalist scholarship that sort of says that Irfan is the antithesis of modernity, it's anti-modern, by showing that it was actually Afghani's early training and formation as a scholar within an Irfani context that shaped and encouraged him to become politically active. Obviously, in the 20th century, the most perfect and the most prominent example of the combination between Irfan and Islamic activism is Ayatollah Khomeini. I mean, Irfan was his actual area of expertise, that was his primary interest, which was quite unusual for a prominent alim. And obviously, I mean, whatever we might think about Khomeini, about the Islamic Revolution, there's no doubt that he was the most influential, the most effective Muslim leader and activist in the 20th century. And again, with him, there's clearly a connection. You're somebody deeply rooted, deeply trained in Irfani thought, and again, the greatest, the most effective, the most influential Muslim activist of the 20th century. And this is not a coincidence. You know, there's a connection between the two, because again, his training in Irfan perhaps allowed him to think, if you like, outside of the box, to develop ideas and to challenge, if you like, traditional scholarships and traditional scholarship and traditional attitudes. Yes, in the context, I mentioned this already, the Shaykhi School. Yes, I mean, what he does, I mean, this is sort of a quote attributed to him, where he refers to a spiritual crisis he experienced as a young man, that he didn't quite know he was studying, he felt it was all superficial, what's the purpose, and so on. And then he found in Irfan, and in particular in the works of the Shaykhi School, of the authors of the Shaykhi School, kind of a solution to his spiritual crisis. Yes, this was the answer, you know, bringing it all together, not seeing philosophy, Sufism, Islam, you know, as contradictions, but they all lead to the same goal. And again, sort of the notion that within Irfan, within sort of the philosophical heritage of Sufism, Afghani found a solution. Now, this is attributed to him, the notion of a spiritual crisis. It resonates very much with the spiritual crisis that Al-Ghazali articulated. So again, within sort of Muslim biographical writings, you know, sort of great scholars, there's a sense of sort of crisis and resolution. So again, it resonates quite a lot with sort of statements Al-Ghazali made, where again, you know, was a very successful sort of prominent scholar, you know, achieving a lot, but felt, is that all? It's all a bit superficial. There must be more. And then in Sufism, he found the solution. He found a way to combine, you know, spiritual devotion with academic scholarship, with sort of legal scholarship, and then obviously leading to bring it together within the Sunni context. So again, when Afghani makes this reference to his own spiritual crisis, he might deliberately allude to, if you like, the spiritual crises of, you know, his ancestors, you know, scholarly ancestors. And we find something very similar in the context of Muhammad Abdu, who similarly articulates in his own sort of autobiography a sense of spiritual crisis and how this was resolved in Sufism. Yes, I mentioned, and again, talk a little bit about how Sayyid Jamal al-Din approached different people. The relationship between Sayyid Jamal al-Din and Muhammad Abdu is very interesting. I mean, I mentioned the kind of spiritual crisis that Abdu refers to in his own sort of autobiographical notes and how he found a solution to this in Sufism. Again, how sort of Abdu was initially also frustrated by the way Islamic scholarship is taught and the kind of intellectual culture that he encountered at Al-Azhar, and then, you know, he became devoted to Sufism and so on. And Sayyid Jamal al-Din, sort of when he encountered Abdu, he responded to the Sufi inclinations of Abdu, and they both entered a kind of murid-murshid relationship in a kind of conventional Sufi context, where sort of Afghani Sayyid Jamal al-Din became, you know, the spiritual guide, the murshid for Muhammad Abdu. However, with a very important difference, that it was not, if you like, a murid-murshid relationship in the conventional sense, where it's all about spiritual progress and so on, achieving fana. Sayyid Jamal al-Din was using this to guide Abdu to political activism. So there's obviously a whole range of sort of Irfani teachings that Sayyid Jamal al-Din taught Abdu and so on, that's part of the training. But more central was to use these as a foundation to become politically active. One sort of literary articulation of Sayyid Jamal al-Din's sort of philosophical Irfani instructions is a book written by Abdu, you know, the first book he wrote, Risalat al-Walidat, the Treatise of Musical Inspirations, which probably is a record of Sayyid Jamal al-Din's sort of philosophical instructions. And it is replete, it's full of references to, you know, teachings of the Shaykhi School and so on. Now, there is a little bit of controversy of the authorship around this, that obviously a person like Muhammad Abdu, who sort of the kind of Salafi appropriation of his personality, that somebody, you know, sort of presented as sort of the beacon, the defender of Sunni orthodoxy in the 19th century, that he was influenced by, you know, Shi'i philosophy, Irfani thought, is unthinkable. So, you know, contemporary authors like Muhammad Imara, for example, would say, oh, this wasn't written by Abdu, you know, Afghani, say Jamal al-Din wrote it, because, you know, these ideas don't fit into his worldview. So there's obviously a kind of, you know, Salafi take on this, because it doesn't fit into the image that has been created around Muhammad Abdu. I suppose, again, reading this text within the context of a murid-murshid relationship, I mean, whether Abdu wrote it, whether Sayyid Jamal wrote it, but certainly what it is, it's a record of the kind of intellectual formation, the philosophical training that Sayyid Jamal al-Din gave Abdu. So in a sense, it's a kind of record, like sort of class notes, if you like, that Muhammad Abdu took. So I think in a sense, it's a bit ambivalent, it's not quite clear who the actual author is. Now, I don't want to sort of talk too much about the treatise as such, it's also running out of time. In a sense, if you read it sort of superficially, it's a good summary of major themes that have been raised in Islamic philosophy, such as, you know, proofs of God's existence. There's a reference, although the term as such is not used, to Wahdat al-Wujud, you know, the unity of being, that is sort of articulated. There's a cosmology, you know, understanding of creation based on emanation, that sort of God didn't create the world out of nothing, but that creation is a constant process, and creation means sort of the manifestation of divine attributes in the world. Again, there's a kind of philosophical reading of prophecy, you know, the notion that there are individuals who are intellectually, spiritually gifted, you know, the perfect man, and again, philosophers and prophets sort of adopting different approaches to teach the same ideas. In a sense, if you read it, it's a good, sort of a good summary, like an introductory textbook into Islamic philosophy, into Irfani thought. Again, a bit unusual that it would come from somebody who was at that time a student or recent graduate of Al-Azhar, because these themes obviously weren't necessarily taught there. But there's nothing sort of revolutionary around it.